सर, थैंक यू। ओके, नमस्ते सर, नमस्ते।
ठीक है, फिर हम लोग यहाँ से बज गए और सेशन शुरू करते हैं USB2 का। सो वेलकम एवरीबॉडी टू दिस लेक्चर 24 ऑफ USB2। सो वी हैव बीन टॉकिंग अबाउट द ह्यूमन डिजायर एंड इट्स फुलफिलमेंट through right understanding, right feeling and right thought, which we are calling as resolution. And then we were trying to unfold this resolution, trying to understand the details of this resolution. And we said that resolution means I have to have the clarity of right understanding, the wisdom, the science. I have to have the clarity of behavior, work and participation in the larger order. And I have to have the clarity of undivided human society, the universal human order and the human tradition. Which in a sense means that I have to have the clarity of all aspects of human existence. And these are the 9 aspects which we can recognize, right, as important aspect of human existence. So this is where we had started in our discourse on USB2. And then we said that we will try to unfold this, try to get into the details of each one of them and try to get the clarity of each of these aspects. So we began with this, you know, trying to understand what right understanding is. And then we looked to the understanding of the human being, understanding of existence, and then understanding of the human conduct, which is, you know, born out of this understanding of the human being and the existence. With that understanding, with that clarity about the right understanding, about the knowledge, then last session we talked about the wisdom, you know, how we are able to identify the human goal on the basis of this right understanding of the existence, the human being, and the role of human being in this existence. Now, in this session, what we intend to do is to talk about the science, right, about how to fulfill human goal. So once this goal is fixed, we have been able to identify this human goal at the level of wisdom. Now I will certainly like to work out the details of how to ensure the fulfillment of human goal. And this detail I am going to work out at the level of my imagination, at the level of my desire, thought and expectation. Right. This in general we are calling as dimension of thought. So now we have to work at the level of our imagination, which is basically trying to work out the detail of how to fulfill this human goal, which we have identified in our contemplation as wisdom, right, on the basis of right understanding. So that is the issue. That is what we are going to talk about when we are saying science. So science is trying to work out the detail of how to fulfill human goal. So that's what we have written in the title. So all encompassing resolution that we are talking about, we will talk about the science, right? Science of how to fulfill human goal, which we have the clarity of in our, you know, last session, that wisdom. So basically with this, now if you look at science, you can see that science has to do with how to ensure fulfillment of human goal. That is what is the issue of science, or what this is what science is, to work out how to ensure fulfillment of human goal. Its thought, its expectation, its detailing. And this detailing will include, of course, the plan of how to ensure the fulfillment of human goal, the program for it, the implementation of it, the result of it, and the evaluation of it. So science will include all this. The plan for fulfillment of human goal, the program, the implementation, the results, the evaluation. And now you can see all this is going to happen first at the level of our thought, at the level of our imagination. So whatever we work out at the level of our imagination for fulfillment of human goal, which we have identified at the level of our contemplation. So this we must be clear, what is the placement of science, or what is science as a reality, as a phenomena which is taking place in the self of human being. So science is something which is taking place in the self of human being. And what is it that is taking place? That is at the level of self, we are working out the details of how to ensure the fulfillment of human goal. We are making plan for it, program for it, how to implement that program, what will be the results, how we will evaluate this, and so on. All these are, you know, part of my imagination, part of my desire, thought, and expectation. Okay. And this whole thing is what we are calling as science. So look into this definition of science, reflect on it. If there are any questions, and I think there will be many questions because we have different notions of science now. So there will be many questions that we'll take up after this, at the end of this session. Now we can see if this is clear, then now in this context, let us look at these two things. Human living. If you look at this human living, it has these three parts. Number one is human understanding, right? That is understanding the human being, the existence, and so on. And on the basis of that, understanding the human goal. So understanding of the existence, the human being in existence, is part of my understanding. Identifying the human goal is now as part of this understanding only, but it is termed as wisdom. Then we have human thought or imagination, which is, you know, human. That is how to fulfill this human goal. So defining, definite feeling, and variety in selecting. So this is what we just said, that when I am trying to work out these details of how to fulfill the human goal, there are values which are definite. So the feelings are definite. But when it comes to applying it in the world outside, that situation and the conditions, it may be different. So there can be a variety in that world outside. And therefore, there can be variety at the level of selecting. So if you look at the thought, you know, as a whole, the one end is definite. That is the end of value, the desire, the feeling is definite. The other end may be varying. And therefore, this thought will have both the content. Right? Its motivation comes from something definite. But it is tied to something which may be varying. So that variation in thought is because of the conditions outside. That definiteness in thought is because of its motivation coming from the values, from the wisdom. If you don't have that wisdom, then you are stuck. Then everything starts coming from outside. And then you have no base. Right? You are lost. Lost in this river. But anyway, so through human thought, through human imagination, I am able to see how to fulfill the human goal. Right? And that is what we are calling as science. The third thing is the human behavior, the human work, human participation. This is the expression outside in the external world. And there you will have lot of variety. There you will have lot of variety. Okay. And this is called as behavior. This is called as character. The behavior, the work, the participation in the larger order. So when I'm saying behavior here, it means behavior, work, and participation. So this placement, we should have that clarity about that when we are saying understanding, what does it mean? When we are saying wisdom, what does it mean? When we are saying science, what does it mean? And when we are saying character or behavior, work, what does it mean? So I've placed this in general, but as and when we will be working on this specific issue, we will take that definition and expand it further. There is another important observation which I have included here, but which is not immediate concern. But it is useful, at least when we will talk about culture and civilization and things like that, then we will be able to relate to it. So this science, this thought is what leads to a culture. So when I say culture, what does it mean? It means this science, this thought of the collectivity. So it is taking place in individuals. Individuals have thought, have their own way of going about the plan for reaching the human goal, the program and all those things. But collectively also we have something common, and that something common collectively is what we are calling as culture. So if I have to evaluate a culture, I have to evaluate the human goal that they have identified as a collective and their general program for fulfillment of that human goal. What is their common plan, program, implementation, and so on. So that relates to the culture. Science relates to the culture. And this character, this behavior, work, relates to the civilization. So this is the, you know, definition of culture and civilization or meaning of culture and civilization that we are going to use. But don't take them as the only, you know, definition. There have been many other concepts related with this culture and civilization in the past, but at least we should have the clarity that there is one reality which says that we have some thought as an individual and we have some thought as collectivity. That thought as collectivity is what we are calling as culture. And this behavior, work and participation, the character as collectivity is what we are calling as civilization. So this is one thing for the placement of science. In connection with this again, that if we look at this science, it is essentially trying to work out the details of expression of this coexistence, expression of living in coexistence. So that is another thing. And if you look at this science as details of expression of living in coexistence, then we can see the placement of this. Basically, we have existence as coexistence, which is a unit submerged in space. And with this realization, we have the understanding that the nature is in harmony and that every unit in nature is self-organized in space. It is participating in the larger order, right? At the level of contemplation, we are able to see that every unit is participating in the larger order. So we have this participation in the larger order. And then when we come down to units, we can see that there are units in nature which are in relationship, a relationship of mutual fulfillment. And there we have this human-human relationship, and there is this human-best of nature relationship. So this human-human relationship is what we are calling as behavior, and human-best of nature relationship is what we are calling as work. So now if you look at science, which is trying to work out the details of how to ensure the fulfillment of human goal, then it is related on the one hand to the coexistence, the harmony and relationship as its motivation. And it is also related to this behavior work and participation in the larger order, which we are doing the world outside. And therefore, this world outside, the situation there, the state there is also important. So science has to take care of both, because it is basically trying to take stock of the details of expression in living in coexistence. So if, you know, I have to work out the details of how to live in this coexistence, I have to take care of all this. On the one hand, I have to have this clarity, understanding of coexistence, harmony and relationship at the background of thought. And we have to have this clarity about the foreground, that is the situation outside, so that on the basis of these two, I can work out my process, right? Details of how to go about. So science includes both the motivation from understanding and expression in the world outside. So it will take relevant understanding or information from both sides, and on the basis of this, we'll complete the process of thought, thinking, to work out these details of this plan, this program. So with this, now, if this is the way we define science, right, that is the detailing of how to ensure fulfillment of human goal, right, then we will have different aspects of science. So these are three of them: the science of behavior, the science of work, and science of participation in the larger order. So when we are trying to work out how to fulfill the human goal, right, what we are going to do outside is, number one, the behavior; number two, the work; number three, the participation in the larger order, which we have just explained. Therefore, when I'm talking about science, I have to talk about the details of each one of them. I have to talk about the science of behavior. I have to talk about the science of work. And I have to talk about the science of participation in the larger order. So how do I behave so that it helps in fulfillment of human goal? How do I work, or what work do I do to fulfill the human goal? And how do I participate in the larger order so that the human goal is fulfilled? So this is very interesting and very important. Number one, you have to find out whether all these are part of science are important, or we only have to look for the science of work. So that question you have to keep asking, whether all these three aspects of science are important, or we only have to pay attention to science of work. So we'll see as we go along. If we look at the way we are going today in the name of science, we are at the most focusing on science of work. And that too, not in a very comprehensive manner, but in a very partisan manner. But that we will see as we go on. But I'm just posing this question right now with the view that you can keep evaluating this as we go along, as to whether we are taking care of the science of behavior, work and participation altogether, or our major focus is only on the science of work. So this is one thing. Then let us define little bit, you know, about each one of them. So this science of behavior would mean how to ensure justice, mutual happiness in human-human relationships, starting from family to world family. How to ensure justice, that is mutual fulfillment in human-human relationship. And this we must be able to do at least at the level of family. And of course, we would like to go forward. We'll be able to ensure it in my village, in my city, in my district, in my nation, and ultimately in the whole world family. So when we were talking about relationship, you know, in the family or harmony in the family, if you remember in EHB1, we talked about it in quite detail. So there we were essentially talking about the science of behavior. We'll recall that for our ready reference, for putting it in the right placement. But you can think, you know, recall, I mean, you can reflect back and see that when we were talking about harmony and family, we were essentially talking about science of behavior. Then we have science of work, and this science of work means how to ensure mutual enrichment in human rest of nature relationship. That is ensuring prosperity in human being and preservation of rest of nature. So this is important, that we are interacting with human being, and that comes under the category of behavior. We are also interacting with rest of nature. That comes under the category of work. And when we are interacting with the rest of nature, we have to take care of two things, right? We have to ensure that it results into prosperity in human being. So human being, out of this work, out of this production, out of this interaction with rest of nature, is able to feel that prosperity, have a feeling of prosperity. So through this interaction with rest of nature, human beings are able to produce more than what is required. And of course, at the background, there is an understanding of what is required. So this more than what is required, giving rise to a feeling of prosperity. So this is one outcome of my interaction with rest of nature. Other outcome, you know, important outcome is that it also leads to preservation of nature and not exploitation of nature. Because if it leads to exploitation of nature, it will go contrary to human good. If it exploits other human being in behavior, it goes against the fulfillment of human good. So this is about science of work. We will go into little more details as we go forward. But I am placing these, you know, definitions for your clarity, so that you can clearly look at what is the reality that is indicated by this science of behavior and science of work. Similarly, the science of participation in the larger order has to do with how to participate in the societal systems, in the dimensions of human order, in order to ensure fulfillment of human goal, starting from family order to world family order. So when we are talking about harmony in the society, if you recall in UHB1, we were essentially trying to work on this science of participation in the larger order. Science of participation in the larger order. So we identified the human goal, and then we identified the systems through which this human goal can be fulfilled. So we identified those five systems through which these four human goals can be fulfilled, right? So that is what we have been talking about, you know, how the human goal can be fulfilled through the participation in the societal system, right, of human order. So that harmony in society, we are essentially talking about this aspect, about the science of participation in the larger order leading to fulfillment of human goal. And there we said that at least at the level of family, we can, you know, start this ensuring our participation in the larger order leading to fulfillment of human goal. But we would not like to stop there. We'd like to go forward, you know, starting from family to world family. So this is about the participation in the larger order, the science of participation in the larger order. Regarding the science of work, you know, when we were talking about harmony in nature, one of the important aspects that we discussed was what is our mutual fulfillment with rest of nature. And in that light, we talked about the mutually enriching cyclic process that is going on in the nature. And we also said that we as human being, if we understand this harmony in nature and our mutual fulfillment with the rest of the order, then we will evolve the system of production and work which ensures this mutual and cyclic, you know, cyclic and mutually enriching process of production. So if you recall, we did talk about this mutually enriching, you know, cyclic process of production, which is going on in the nature, and that we have to understand, and we also have to ensure that any process of production and work that we evolve has to be in line with this. So there we were talking about the science of work. So we have already talked about the science of behavior, the science of work, and the science of participation in the larger order in EHB 1 first, and now in the lecture that we had in EHB 2 till now. So look into this, look into these definitions, definition of science or the reality which is indicated by this word science. Then look into these different aspects of science, and then look at each of these aspects which is indicating to some reality. So try to identify, understand those reality. So work on it. Of course, there may be many questions because our notion of science today is quite limited in this sense. So there will be many questions which we will take up. So with this, let us look at some description, some detail about the science of behavior, the science of work, and science of participation in the larger order. I will certainly not go into much detail because many things we have already discussed in EHB 1 and now in EHB 2. So I will just try to, you know, bring them together for your daily reference and for connecting to what we have already discussed. So majority of the detailing, you have to go back and see where it has been discussed before. So I will just give a kind of essence of what we have discussed and connect to those detailed discussion, but you have to go back and look at those detailed discussions. So regarding the science of behavior, we are saying that science of behavior with human being leading to mutual happiness, that is justice, from family to world family, which ultimately leads to undivided society. So science of behavior has to do with, you know, our relationship with human being, you know, its recognition, its fulfillment, leading to mutual happiness. And that is what we are calling justice. And we should start it from family and go right up to the world family, leading to undivided society. So if you look at it, you know, what we have talked about as harmony in family, we have essentially talked about this, you know, science of behavior. We have talked about the justice from family to world family, leading to undivided society. And we have said that this justice, this harmony in family is ensured through relationship. And when we look at relationship, these are the four important aspects, right? The first aspect is that relationship is there between oneself and the other self. Not that we have to make relationship. The relationship is there. We have to understand the relationship. We have to recognize that relationship. And when we recognize the relationship, understand that relationship, then we are able to see that there are feelings in the relationship. And these feelings are in one self for the other self. We also see that these feelings are definite and we can recognize them. And that their fulfillment and their evaluation leads to mutual happiness. So this is the important observation about the relationship that now we can look back and make this direct, you know, observation on all these four aspects regarding the relationship between human being and human being. We also said that these feelings are definite and we can identify them like trust, respect, affection, right up to love. Right. So we identified these feelings, we tried to work out the details, you know, of this feeling. We also tried to see what are the misunderstandings and what are the problems in identifying these feelings, recognizing these feelings, and what are the problems in, you know, expressing these feelings. But if we understand them properly, we can always have these feelings in us, okay, with certainty. And that itself makes us, you know, in harmony within ourselves in a state of happiness. And with that harmony and happiness and with that feeling in us, we can express this feeling with others. We can share with this feeling with others, irregardless of whether the other is able to ensure this or not. So these details we have seen. So you have to recall all that. Okay. You know, go back to these discussions and recall certain few more points I will certainly mention as we go along. So we said that this all put together, recognition of relationship and fulfillment of it leading to mutual fulfillment, you know, is what is called justice. That we define that justice is recognition, fulfillment, and evaluation of human-human relationship leading to mutual happiness. And we also said that we want to ensure this justice from family to world family. And if that happens, it will result into an undivided society. The society which we have, which is divided into so many parts, and therefore so many oppositions, so many struggle and war, we'll be able to resolve that. Then, certain observations based on what we have just mentioned. Number one, relationship is, it already exists, we just need to realize it between oneself and the other self. The base of relationship is feelings in oneself or the other self. These feelings are definite, they can be understood, they can be identified, they can be recognized. Then justice in relationship is basically understanding relationship. Acceptance of this relationship. Once we have the acceptance, having the right feelings in oneself, and then expressing these feelings with the other, the right evaluation of these feelings leading to mutual happiness. So these are the steps which are, you know, involved in the process of ensuring justice. So which in a sense means having the right understanding and right feeling in myself leading to my happiness. Expressing and sharing these feelings to the other and its right evaluation by the other leading to his or her happiness. So very important. We have put it in two parts. One is having the right understanding and right feeling of relationship in myself. If I have this, it leads to my happiness. So my happiness is guaranteed once I have the right understanding about relationship and right feelings in relationship. So my happiness is guaranteed. And this we have seen many times, you know, when we are working through exercise. One, that whenever we have this feeling of relationship, harmony and coexistence. Right? We are in harmony within and therefore in a state of happiness within. Even when we are not expressing it outside, even when the other is not welcoming it, right? The moment I have a feeling which is in line with this feeling in relationship, these natural feelings in relationship, I am in a state of harmony within and happiness within. So if I have the right feeling in me in relationship, it leads to my happiness. If I express this feeling to the other, right, and if the other is also is able to make a right evaluation of this, then it leads to his or her happiness. And if both these conditions are satisfied, it leads to mutual happiness. So when I have the right understanding and I have the right feeling in relationship, my happiness is ensured. But when I'm expressing it to the other, his happiness will depend upon, number one, my expressing this feeling reaching to him, and he making the right evaluation of this feeling. Then it will result into his happiness also. And as I said, both the conditions put together will result into mutual happiness. So this is very important, that this right understanding and right feeling about relationship in me will ensure happiness in me that very moment. But whether it will lead to happiness in the other or not will depend upon whether I am expressing this feeling or not, whether it is reaching to the other or not, and whether the other is able to make a right evaluation of it or not. If both the conditions are satisfied, then only the mutual happiness will take place. So therefore, when I have to see it from my side, you know, my responsibility in ensuring mutual fulfillment is, number one, having the right understanding about relationships, then having the right feeling in relationship, right? And therefore being in a state of harmony and happiness within. With this state of harmony and happiness within, with these feelings in relationship, now I'll have to express this feeling, you know, in the world outside. I'll have to make sure that this feeling, you know, reaches to the other. And I also have to make sure that other person is able to rightly evaluate this feeling. Because if that competence is not there in the other, then it will not lead to happiness. It might lead to even unhappiness. So it is part of my responsibility to make sure that the other person is able to receive the feeling and also rightly evaluate the feeling. And if he is missing competence for this, it is my responsibility to help him improve his competence. So I cannot just say that the other is incompetent, is not able to evaluate rightly my feeling, my expression of the feeling. So I don't bother, or I can't do anything. I may not be able to do anything immediately, but if I take this responsibility, I will slowly work out the way. So in fact, all our, you know, kind of effort to bring this, you know, to common people, bring it through education, is to help people develop their competence so that they can receive our feeling, you know, and evaluate it properly, and therefore get happiness out of it. And if they are able to, you know, evaluate the feeling correctly and, you know, derive happiness out of it, it will continue. This process of multiplication will continue. So all our sharing is in the context of this responsibility to, you know, help the other to develop competence for evaluating the feeling properly, correctly. So when you are working with your family members, you are behaving with your family member, you have to take this responsibility that you have to have the understanding of relationship. You have to have this feeling in relationship. know, with that in a state of harmony and happiness within, with that express these feelings in, with the other member of the family. Make sure that it reaches to the other and make sure that he has the competence to evaluate the feeling rightly, correctly. Then only the mutual fulfillment will be guaranteed. And if he does not have the competence, then I will certainly try to be a help to these members in the family to develop that understanding and that feeling, competence to evaluate that feeling. So this is what you must have been doing, many of you, you know, at least you must have been strongly feeling that if I have understood something and I'm able to ensure those feeling in me, you know, it is better that other family members also develop this understanding and feeling, and therefore the competence to evaluate my feeling at least to begin with, and then have the right feeling in themselves, and therefore having the right behavior with me and others. So all this we are doing, but it's a natural phenomena which we must understand the basic principles of behavior. And of course, this has to expand starting from family to world family. So this all we have discussed in quite detail in SB1, particularly this relationship issue we have discussed in quite detail in SB1. And even if you look at this book, which is developed around this SB1, has a significant part, which is dealing with this issue of relationship. So go back, look at that. I will again put some essence of what we have been discussing there. So in a sense, we have been saying, ultimately, it is the feeling of love which has to develop, and which has to be lived with, which has to be practiced in behavior. So let me define this love. So this love is the realization of coexistence, and therefore the acceptance of being related to all. So love, feeling of love has two, you know, basis. One is understanding that existence is in the form of coexistence, it is in the form of harmony, it is in the form of relatedness. And then on the basis of this understanding, the acceptance that I am related to all. Acceptance of being related to all. That is the feeling of love. But as we said, this acceptance of being related to all is based on, is founded on my understanding of coexistence, my realization of coexistence. So this is the ultimate value, this is the ultimate, you know, feeling in relationship. So if you see, the science of behavior is founded on these two things: understanding of coexistence and the feeling of being related to all. Right? Feeling of being related to all. That is what we are calling as love. If we can understand this, then we'll be able to see that all other feelings that we have been talking about, those 9 feelings, are basically the application of this feeling of love in different states, in different situations, in specific cases of our relationship. That we will see. But let us, you know, first define this love and talk about some little description of it. So this love starts with identifying that one is in coexistence with other human beings. That is what we have called as affection. And it slowly expands to the feeling of coexistence with all human beings, and then to all, each and every unit in nature, human being as well as the other units. So that is the feeling of love, being related to all. But you cannot start with this being related to all. Of course, if you are coming from top, that is realization of coexistence, they can start, then you can start with, you know, having this feeling of being related to all, that is feeling of love. But when you are working for it from below, then we will start with identifying our relationship with other human being, at least one human being. And that is what is called as affection. Then it will slowly expand to see the relationship with other human being and ultimately all human beings. And then it will extend further of having relationship with other units of nature and ultimately all units of nature, whether the human being or any other unit. So that is what we are calling as love. This feeling of love is expressed in the form of kindness, beneficence, and compassion, if you remember. So this is how it is expressed, in the form of kindness, in the form of beneficence, and in the form of compassion. And one important thing is that this feeling is there for all, but it is expressed to those who come in contact. So you have the feeling for all human beings and rest of nature, all the units, but you don't go about, you know, expressing it to every individual here and there. But you have this feeling in you. You are there with this feeling, with this thought all the time. Right? And you express it to the other, whoever comes in contact. And the other units anyway keep coming in contact. So whenever they are in contact with you, you will express these feelings with the other unit, other person. So this is important. And we are saying that when we have this feeling of love, it will be expressed in the form of compassion. Ultimately, it is expressed in the form of compassion, which means that I am ready to express, to fulfill this relationship with the other unit unconditionally. Right. So if you recall this definitions of this, okay, we'll come back to that later. The definition that we said about this kindness, beneficence, and compassion. I will only define this compassion here. When we talk about this human participation, we'll define these three things there. So compassion essentially means that when I'm able to see my relationship with the other, with all, I have that responsibility in me that I must fulfill this relationship with everyone. So all the details that I think in terms of fulfilling this relationship with the other is called compassion. And one important aspect of this compassion is that I am having this responsibility, right, to fulfill my relationship with the other unconditionally. So I am not putting any condition on the other, whether he is competent or incompetent. As I am related to the other, I can see that. Therefore, it is my responsibility to fulfill relationship with the other. And therefore, I do it in regard of his competence. So in regard of his competence or lack of it, I am willing to fulfill my relationship with him unconditionally. That is the feeling of compassion. So if you remember, we have been saying that the essence of what we are talking about all through is understanding of coexistence, that is understanding of truth. Then on the basis of understanding of this truth, this coexistence, having the feeling of love, and as an outcome of this, as an expression of this, we have the feeling of compassion. Fulfillment, this responsibility to fulfill relationship with every unit in nature unconditionally, that compassion. So truth, love and compassion are the essence of all that we have been talking about, and to the essence of all that, you know, whole tradition, the human tradition has been talking about, right? Whoever has realized the truth, realized the existence, right, has talked about this, the truth, the love, the compassion. They might have used different words, different sequence, different way of expression, but this is the essence of what, you know, all great people in the history have been talking about, all realized people in the history have been talking about. And in that sense, you know, most of the philosophy that we have today in the world, and even most of the religion, at the base of it, you will find that it is this understanding of the coexistence, the truth, having the feeling of being related to all that is love, and willingness to share this, express this feeling of being related it with everyone unconditionally, that is compassion. And of course, this leads to this state of undivided society. We have the feeling of love. At least for me, right, I am related to everyone, you know, and this can become a basis for an undivided society, first in me, and then I can work for it, make it realizable outside. Some, you know, discussion on this, that the other feeling that we talk about is basically the expression of love. Right. So I'll just mention very briefly that if we have the feeling of being related to all, that is the complete value, then we can see that it expresses itself in different forms, right? Depending upon the state, upon the situation, upon the specific cases of relationship. So for example, trust is basically this able to see that the other is related to me and I am related to the other. So this acceptance, this basic acceptance that I am related to the other is related to me at the base of the design of this coexistence, is what is trust. So to be assured that the other intends my happiness and prosperity, that the other is in relationship and not in opposition. This is trust. When we talk about respect, it is basically evaluating the other person rightly, but at the base is that we are related to each other and we have to be complementary to each other. It is with this at the background that we are evaluating the other, rightly evaluating the other. If you look at affection, it is basically the acceptance of other as one's relative. When I accept that the other is related to me, that is called affection. And this affection expands to love finally. Similarly, care, guidance, all these are basically expression of this feeling of love at different levels, in different situations, different conditions. So look at this. I will not go into the details of it. You can reflect on it, and if there are questions, we can take it up. So then there are this right feeling within and feeling from the other, these issues. So look at this. One point which I just mentioned before we close our discussion about the science of behavior. In relationship, these three things are important that we have just discussed. Number one is right understanding is important. Number two, right feeling is important. And number three, its expression in terms of behavior is important. So understanding of coexistence is important. on the basis of it, having the right feeling in the self is important, which results into my happiness. Then expression of this feeling in behavior is important. Expression with the other human being is important, and this leads to mutual happiness. So this we have to keep in mind, that when we talk about relationship, when we are talking about science of behavior, the foundation of science of behavior is right understanding. That is understanding of coexistence, harmony, and relationship. Then it results into right feeling. That is feeling of trust, respect, affection, and right up to love in the self. And if we have these feelings, which is in line with this relationship, harmony, and coexistence, it will lead to a state of happiness in the self. And then it has to do with the behavior. Expression of these feelings, which is based on right understanding in our relationship with other human beings. So these are the three important aspects when we are talking about science of behavior. So this we have to keep in mind. I think with this, I must throw this open for question regarding the science of work and participation in the larger order. We'll take it up in the next session. So let me just close this presentation from my side regarding the science of behavior by saying that the important thing to ask yourself now is that, what are you working for in your relationship with other human beings? Are you working for ensuring right feeling within, or are you working for getting the feeling from others? So even when you are working on relationship, focusing on relationship, these are two possibilities that we should keep in mind. And the first one is the right possibility, that is ensuring right feeling within. The second one will always put us in trouble, put us in trouble and put other in trouble. So let me just explain what I am saying. When you have the right feeling within, basically it means that you have the right understanding of relationship, harmony, and coexistence. You are aware of it and you are guided by it. You are guided means your feelings, your imagination is guided by it. So this ensures that you have the right feeling within, which is leading to a state of happiness within you. And this is definite, this is continuous, this is unconditional. Then this right understanding and right feeling now has become your property, and it is not dependent on the other. Right? And you are in a state of self-organization, you are in a state of svatantrata. So this is very important. That are we working for this? Are we working for ensuring right understanding in ourselves, which is understanding of harmony, coexistence, and relationship? Are we working for ensuring right feeling in relationship based on this right understanding, which is definite, which is universal, which is continuous, unconditional? So are we working for this? Are we working for making this as one of my property, which is not dependent on the other? If we are able to do it, if we are trying to do it, we are working for our self-organization, working for certain stuff. On the other hand, you don't have this feeling, definite feeling in you. It keeps fluctuating. It depends on the other. If the other expresses right feeling, you feel happy. If the other expresses wrong feeling, you feel unhappy. And this indicates that you do not have the right understanding in you, right feeling in you, and you are dependent on the other. Right? So in terms of feeling, you are dependent on the other. You are in a state of self-enslavement, right? In a state of patantrata. So you are enslaved by the behavior of the other. You do not have your definite behavior, definite feeling, definite understanding. So you are not in a state of self-organization, in a state of satyantrata. Rather, you are in a state of enslavement state of patanchita. So keep asking this question, you know, what is your state and where are you working for? Are you working for ensuring right feeling within and thereby behaving on the basis of that right feeling? Or you are trying to expect, you know, trying to work to get right feeling from the other, right behavior from the other. So with this, I will throw open this session for questions. Of course, I can see there'll be many questions, but before closing, let me just place this, some of these questions for your self-reflection. Work with this first one and the second one. We have this theme that science can be expanded as science of behavior, work and participation. In the present day science, or present day notion of science, are we taking care of all these or only the science of work? And in that too, are we taking care of all aspects of it, of science of work, or only some limited aspect of it? This is what you have to reflect on, and then we can discuss. Second is, in the science of behavior, what will be the priority of understanding, feeling, and physical facility? And what is the role of